I want to thank everybody for tuning in, man. We got a special guest in the building, man. We got Pass in the building. What's up, Pass?
What's up, Ryan? How you doing?
How you feeling, man?
I'm good.
How's everything been, man?
Everything's good.
How's the tattoo business going?
It's kicking right now. After Christmas, it's been booming, man.
That's what's up, man. Yeah, I've been seeing a lot of your new work, man. And it's crazy, bro. It's like you just keep getting better and better and better, man. Like, I remember when, you know, I first met you, and it's like the work just keeps, like, it's amazing, bro.
Yeah, I guess it just keeps evolving. You keep doing the same shit over and over.
Yeah, definitely, man. But, so, Paz, what made you start writing graffiti?
I guess I was in high school somewhere in the Northeast, Philly, and I always drew in black books and shit, but I kind of wanted a way to, like, be able to do art outside, not just in books or just on canvas, and, like, be able to more communicate with people. So I linked up with a couple of writers that I went to high school with, and it kind of just took off from there. Met writers from downtown, met writers in art school, and it just kind of filtered out from there.
Like, a lot of artists now that I see getting into the tattoo business, is like, some of them did graffiti before, some of them were artists. Like, how much did graffiti play part in your tattoo career past?
I wouldn't really say a lot. I mean, I think tattooing is a totally different genre. I think with graffiti, it's a lot more specific. Like, it has a lot to do with just letter formations and being able to manipulate letter forms, where tattooing is more like, you got to be able to basically draw anything to be successful. Like, you can't just worry about typography or just design. So you kind of have to be like a jack of all trades in order to do tattooing.
Definitely. So tattooing is not as easy as people think.
No.
Just because you can do graffiti don't mean you're going to become a great tattoo artist.
No. I mean, you can be able to tattoo mediocre, maybe, and you might be able to trace lines.
You have
lines.
To put the time in, though.
Yeah, in order to make it to the artistic level, yes. You have to put your time into anything.
Definitely, man. So, Paz, who were some of your influences when you first started writing graffiti?
First started writing graffiti. It's funny. My influence is kind of spiraled out from the people I met. I mean, the first writers I met were obviously in high school. They were just like Northeast writers, and then I met a couple like downtown writers, or like kind of, I guess you'd call like, Philly writers. Like, Wars was actually the first writer I met.
Wars, shout out to Wars. He was crazy with them pieces, definitely.
Yeah. We both went to community college, so I met him in an art class, and I met Bird in college too, and we kind of like synced up artistically very well, and we started doing pieces together. And I remember Wars was kind of like Dan Wong's young boy, and I met Dan because he came down when I was painting with Wars. And it kind of all went from there.
And that's how all that whole movement came about.
Right? Absolutely, yeah.
The Dan, the Just, the, mm-hmm. the, you know, the Sands. How did you ever get to paint with Sonny Wasett?
With who?
Wasett.
Said? No, yeah. Actually.
You actually never have, you never
know,
have
nah, never.
Do you know him?
Yeah, Sonny, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Just imagine what y'all would have done.
I mean, we met a couple times, but, like, he was painting with Jesk and Pri.
Yes.
And I was kind of painting with Dan a lot.
Yeah.
And Bird. So our like, we never got together and actually did a wall where it was me and him on the same wall.
Okay. Well, I'm going to take it back. Who was your first graffiti partner, and what was the first crew you ever wrecked?
First crew and last crew I ever wrecked was...
Nine Circle?
Nine Circle.
Definitely.
We started that when I was still in high school, and I always just kept with it, and it just kind of... I mean, it became more of like a hardcore crew, and we were going to hardcore shows together and stuff like that, but... Like, it definitely had its graffiti origins.
So, past. The past now. The artists that you are now. Mm-hmm. What artists from around the world do you, like, look at their work and sometimes, get some ideas or you just like? Like, what dudes around the world you like? Like, what artists are in past, lists that you look at?
Gotcha. Well, I can give you the list of like the artists that I follow on Instagram.
Definitely, yeah.
Revoke, MSK.
Definitely. Shout out to Revoke, man. It would be a pleasure to get him up here. I think we'll have to pay for his plane ticket.
I think you would.
We can get it done. Shout out to the whole MSK, man.
Yeah. Saber, MSK.
Mm-hmm.
I like Sever a lot.
He's mean.
Yeah. Espo was a big influence.
Shout out to Espo.
Sweat from Denmark. Mr. Green.
Mm.
You familiar with him?
Nah, not too much, but I might have to do my homework now that you told me about him.
Yeah. I'm trying to think who else.
So just like the ordinary top guy, like Risk. Do you like Risk? Dudes like them?
No, actually, no. I don't like
it. Okay.
I don't like those guys that use like a million colors.
Yeah, it's crazy. You know what definitely. I mean? But Paz, if I could take you back, right? How old was you when you took your first paint tag?
Outside, not in a book. Probably like 16, 17.
Like 16? So you was like 16, and what's your favorite paint to use? Like, what does Paz like?
American Accents. American Accents were my favorite, but they're kind of hard to come by.
Yeah, now they're hard to come by.
And you need the converter.
Yeah, so you still keep it old school. Like, you can still do clean stuff with Rusto. That's crazy. That's awesome.
Most of the shit that I started with in the 90s, that was all Rusto.
That's awesome. Back in the day, Dan and all of y'all never used Montana's and none of that. Yeah. It was strictly American Accent, I remember. Damn, that's awesome.
Maybe like Krylon to Outline.
Oh yeah, Krylon, yeah. But if the European paint was in like how it is right now,
It was too expensive back then anyway.
Definitely.
I think it was like $5 a can, and that was back then.
Like, who would you like to rock and roll with?
It's probably gonna sound weird, but probably Twist, even though I probably can't, because I'm probably gonna need some serious smelling salts, but probably Twist out of all people. And sad to say that probably never happened.
Why you chose Twist?
Because he's nothing like me. And I thought, I always thought when people paint together, I thought it'd be cool if their styles are nothing alike.
Right.
You know what I mean? Instead of two people that like, they always paint together and their styles kind of look the same.
Definitely.
The opposite of that.
So by you saying that, how important to you is originality? Because when somebody looks at your pieces, they're original. You do you used to do the tree thing. Mm-hmm. You do the little, spiky thing. So how important it was for you to come out and be original with your own style?
That was the most important thing. I'd rather be not so famous, but famous for what I do, than famous for something that isn't 100% mine.
What's the first name you wrote before you actually came up with the name Paz and you blew up? Like that, obviously taught you into what you know now.
Yeah, I fucked around with Dox, D-O-X, for a while. And that was just kind of like, I just picked three letters that I liked, you know what I mean? And then when I was writing, this was back in high school, and then after that, that's when I started really giving it some thought and like trying to come up with like a whole alternate identity, you know what I mean? Where it wouldn't just be like a graph name, something I wrote on a wall. It would be like, almost like picking your alter ego.
If you could go back, right, to when you first like was busting out hard, what year was that? Because I remember we go back, remember we was in Artscape together, mm-hmm. and around that time, it's like that's when you started to like, you know, like started to, you was doing the tree pieces, like you was starting to get out there.
When I was in art school, that's when I called my first case already. So.
Yeah, that's good. So like what year was that that you was like out there like heavy, that little era?
97 to 2000.
And at that time, you was piecing with, like you said, Dan, Jazz, Wars.
Yeah.
Out of all of those guys, like for you, which one you like painting with the most?
Probably Vert. Probably Bert, just because he was versatile. Like he could do anything. He could do characters. He can do landscapes. He can do letters. You know what I mean? So he was just an easy guy to come up with. Not just Dan was cool, but like all he did was like letters and triangles. You know what I mean? So Bert offered a little bit more. Like so when we wanted to amp it up a little bit.
You always like painting with competition. That makes you be better, right?
I never looked at it as competition.
No, not competition, but like somebody that's good. Like,
absolutely.
I love painting with like doing straight letters illegally with Lobo. I love doing that because he does them real clean. Mm-hmm. So he makes me do them clean.
Yeah, you don't want to be the lousy guy on the wall.
Yeah, and even if you are, you know, we all help each other, but it's like, painting with you know, good guys, it makes you, like I remember when I painted with Densky and NM, like I felt great.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? So it was it like that with
them? Absolutely, yeah, because you're vibing off them. It's like playing music with someone or, you know, being in a band together or anything creative. Like if you're with creative people, obviously you're going to pick up and want to do more creative things. You're going to want to go out on that limb more. You know what I mean? Try shit you haven't tried. You know
awesome.
What I mean?
So awesome. How important is it to you to stay real?
Real?
To the graffiti roots. Because you did graffiti before tattooing, right?
Absolutely, yeah, absolutely.
So you would never leave graffiti?
Well, no, I would never leave graffiti, but there's no reason. Graffiti's part of my identity.
Exactly.
I feel it's as natural as waking up in the morning. You know what I mean? Like it's like asking like, do you think you'll ever stop showering? No, probably not.
Damn, this is your life, bro. Like you live this.
Yeah, and since tattooing, I figured out a way to make money off it, so I ain't going nowhere.
That's awesome. So a lot of people are like asking, you know, answering these questions, but you know, people want to know a lot about you. So, what's your favorite five graffiti writers, and then I want you to break down, because a lot of people don't know about the tattoo life like you do.
Mm.
So then I want you to give me your five tattoo artists. Let's start with graffiti.
All right. I would say Twist, Espo, Revoke, Sever, and Sweat, probably. That's probably my top five.
And how about in tattooing?
Grimes, one of my favorite tattoo artists, but that's just because he kind of did the same thing I did beforehand. Like, he actually came from the graffiti world, too. And Philip Liu, he's a tattooer out of France. He's real good. Actually, one of my favorite tattoo artists is Paul Acker. I actually worked with him at Deep Six for a long time. Actually, there's a guy named Bugs who was doing cubism style tattoos that I really liked. And another one, Guy Atchison, he's from the Midwest. He's real good at like organic, like rootsy type stuff.
some of the people you like and decided that, okay, this is what they do and I'm going to do this? Or from the door, you just did you and just came up with your own style from the rip?
Well, I did try to build it up from the ground up and try not to really, like, copy anybody's letter forms. Like, I wasn't going to look at, like, oh, there's a pre-piece, let me take his pee.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Like, your shit is totally different from everybody I've saw.
I don't think you can really fake that. I think that if you're going to do that, it's just got to be built from the ground up.
Like, I seen a tattoo of a guy. I seen a guy with a tattoo, and I knew you did it.
Yeah.
I knew you did it. Yeah. It's like your style is, like, it's so original, man.
Yeah, I think that comes from, like, consciously, like, don't let what's going on in the tattoo world or in the graph world affect what you're doing.
When you do a tattoo convention and you go out there, do you also like sneak a piece in?
Is it hard? It's hard. I mean, honestly, it's hard because the tattoo convention season usually is in the winter. So most of these cities are, it's real bitter, it's real cold. Plus you're usually hemmed up in a hotel room tattooing. A hotel ballroom tattooing for at least, the booth is usually open 12 hours, you know what I mean, for every day during that weekend. So there's not really much time to sneak away. But I've gone on like longer road trips or like commission trips where like I've gone to LA, I went to Houston, Texas, I went to Austin and just painted murals. But what happened a couple times in my career is, people know that I'm a tattoo artist and I find out that, oh, you do walls and stuff like that. And I've painted a couple tattoo shops around this area. And a couple friends of mine opened tattoo shops up in Austin, Texas. So me and Bird went out there and we just like not only painted their whole shop and designed their shop, we also got to piece and fucking do some illegal stuff while we're out there too. Nice. Like it turned into a whole like artistic type trip, you know what I mean?
But we still have to get together with you and get the song titles and so on. We're coming along pretty good. We just need some final things for you and we should be able to show you something sometime next week.
For the people that are listening that don't really know you, man, like let people know like whatever you really came out of. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like when you was like growing up, when you was still the buck, before you became pastor, before I met you at Artscape and all of that, like who was them dudes out there? Like was you out there for the era like Mr. Blint and them? Mm-hmm. Or was you like out there for the cat era? Like whatever was you like, you know, when you was like, cause like when people ask me what was my era, I say like Catism, Boza, Narc, like you know, dumb dudes.
I would say I came from the same Catism, the Catism era, like the tail end of that, like from 86 to 89.
The True Bears era?
Yeah, and then like Satin Praise when they had that big Allegheny wall.
Yes, rest in peace, Praise, man.
So pretty much like when Care was dominating the rooftops on the L, and Satin Praise were doing their thing, and even the beginning of KMD when Rakan was smashing shit with Sizer.
Rest in peace, Sizer, yeah.
So I guess early 90s was when I really started taking like a serious interest, and I can look back on like late 80s when I first saw the L rooftops and all that shit.
So some of the guys you say was like Care, you know, shout out to Care, great, you know, great graffiti artist.
Ozone,
we had him up here, MB. Mm. So basically we was like around the same era, you know what I'm saying? You know, the Catism, that was the golden era, man.
I think at least like as far as there was tags and there was pieces, everybody, like the people that were out then were doing everything. Like Espo was doing full ass murals and Boza and Catism were catching tags, wrecking bus lines.
Definitely.
And Praise and Sav were getting rooftops. So yes. Like it was a good era to grow up in.
Definitely.
And everybody was living too.
Yeah, bro. Right now, you're into tattoos, you still do graffiti, you're still into the art lifestyle. You said that, like, you wake up with this shit. Like, you live this shit. Would you still go out there and go take illegal tags?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, there's a lot more, there's a lot more to risk, but honestly, I got, like, I'm more financially set, so if I'm gonna get locked up, I'm in a pretty good.
You got bail.
I got bail.
Yeah, and now it's like, don't give a fuck. It's always gonna be in you.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. Being on train tracks, the smell of paint, and like just having fucking paint in your hand, and yeah, and people fucking leaving the fuck alone. You know what I mean? And yeah. Being able to do whatever you want to do. It's the freedom, I think.
Yeah, like, it's like me, you know, like I did it for like other reasons, like trauma. Like I did it because, you know, like an escape. Like everybody does it for a different reason. I know a lot of writers that, you know, they might break up with their girls and that's when they start bombing and get all crazy. It's like we use it as a stress reliever. Have you ever used it like that?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely.
Like, can you give people an example?
Yeah, I mean the whenever I had dark times was usually when I was painting the most. You know what I mean? Like, it wasn't when I was like fell in love and was with a girl. No, I wasn't painting at all. I was happy though. Like, most of the greatest pieces I ever did came from suffering. You know what I mean? Like, whether I was going through a court case or, you know, getting kicked out of school or something like that. You know what I mean?
Now, when you was in high school, man, I remember when I was in high school, man, I can't remember how many times I was, you know, took into the office for writing in school. Well, did you tag in high school?
Yeah, absolutely.
Was you into the scratchies on the buses and all that?
The scratchies on the buses.
I remember drama used to like have every fucking bus.
And taking cracks.
Absolutely, yeah.
So you was into all of that?
Yeah, absolutely. I remember drama actually told me that a lot of times when he was taking them, because I asked him, I was like, how the fuck did you get a time to do those like scratches? That must have taken like at least 45 minutes. He told me he asked like people on the bus to like stand next to him.
Oh, and
cover
shit.
Up exactly where
he was. Body blocking.
Yeah, stand up in the bus, get crowded, and block it up.
Yeah. I think that's the only way it's going to survive. If you want graffiti to have a future, or any kind of street art to have a future, you have to figure out a way to make money off of it so you don't wind up doing something else. You know what I mean? Like, if it wasn't for a tattoo, I don't know what the fuck I'd be doing. You know what I mean?
That's what I try to tell a lot of young artists is, I'll tell them, evolve your art, man. Like, get into something. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, do something. Like, sell mops. Like, do something. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Because it is a good lane. Like, art is a good lane to make money.
But the thing is, I don't think people should go into it trying to make money. But you should definitely keep your ear to the street and figure out ways to make money off something you love. But don't sacrifice it. There's a fine line between selling totally out.
When you're doing a wall, Do you already come with a sketch? You already got a color scheme, or are you more of like a freestyle artist?
Nah, I would always come with a color scheme and a sketch. Right. Very rarely, like.
When you're painting, what goes through your mind? Like, what zone do you get into?
It usually comes in steps. I get to the wall, and I kind of get stressed out about, all right, as soon as I get my sketch onto the wall from paper, I'll be all right. And once I get my sketch onto the wall, I'm like, all right, now the next step is I got to fill it in and do all the designs on the inside. Once I get that, I kind of relax. And then like, all right, the next big thing is I got to fucking outline this thing and make sure it's clean. Mm-hmm. And then after that, you can kind of relax and have fun with like doing the shell and doing whatever background. And then like all the hard part's done and everything, you can just decide like, all right, what's the guy doing next to you? And then you can kind of vibe off him and decide like, oh, what are we going to do in between me and you or blah, blah, blah. You know what I mean? If you're doing like productions, after the pieces are done, everything else is usually just like another, like you're doing another kind of art form. Like you're just painting a landscape or painting whatever. Like it's graffiti because of the letters. Everything else is not really important.
In Philly now, right? What young upcoming artists like do you see that are out there catching wreck?
Like bombers or tigers?
We can keep it in every sense. Like, you know, whether they doing straight letters or they tagging. Like, who do you see out there? Like, what parts of the city you travel and who do you see?
Gotcha.
Like, who does pass see on walls? Or do you even read walls?
I think Deez is doing a lot of shit. I see his shit everywhere I go. The guy that actually he paints with, Krev?
K-R-E-V?
No, C, he does the heavens, like the back of the street signs.
Kress,
my bad.
C-R-E-S?
Yeah.
Yeah, he paints with these?
Yeah.
Yeah, shout out to all of them, yeah.
That's not bad. I see him a lot. Hayes has been doing a lot of...
Hayes, get with me, bro! Get with me, man! We need you up here, Hayes!
You got my number, Jim. Hit me up.
Yeah, that's
my homie. Yeah, he's been doing his thing.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, so if I was to ask you, where do you think graffiti is in Philadelphia? Do you think we're at a good place right now? Do you think we're being represented the right way? Where or why?
Yeah, I think with Scribble Magazine, it's in a good spot as far as like.
Shout out to Pete, out to Matt, the whole Infamous Magazine camp.
No, absolutely.
They definitely showed a lot of Philly to the world.
Absolutely,
they definitely did.
And they probably didn't have.
I gotta give them props for that.
Yeah, because they could have just.
Kept it
in New York and LA and fucking Europe. You know what I mean?
But Philly is the birthplace, so people always.
Absolutely.
You know.
Well, people look at it as like Philly's the birthplace, but. Then, you know, it took a train to New York.
It went somewhere else, yeah, exactly. And it's a beautiful thing because, like, I was telling Cornbread when I had him here, like, I was like, Cornbread, how you feel that, you know, like, you're one of the guys that birthed this, and that was worldwide. And he's like, yo, like, I love it. Like, I love that this shit is in Europe. Like, I love that it's in Hong Kong.
It's in Hong Kong,
and it's like a universal language.
Absolutely.
It's not like music that has got barriers. You might listen to rock and roll, I might listen to hip hop, you might listen to, you know what I mean? But graffiti is all a universal language, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, you can go to any city and see what the kids are thinking.
And the community is like, wherever you land at, right on the gram, I'm here, I write, and people are like, let's paint.
Yeah, no.
It's like the community of graffiti, like they stick together.
Yeah.
You know, we lost a lot of great ones, you know, in the last year. If you had the chance to write with one of the writers that has passed away, one of the legends that has passed away, you know, we had Raz, CR Star, Man, all the great ones that have passed. Like, what writer would you choose?
Praise.
Praise. Rest in peace.
Yeah.
Man. Did you ever write with Praise before?
No, I met him a couple times, but I could never get him out there. I could never get him out there.
Okay.
Yeah, I asked him a bunch of times.
That was a hard one, man. Praise was such a an original like dude. I remember him sad like when they was doing rooftops, man. Like they was killing it. Yeah. Like they brought something different to the rooftops.
Yeah.
They brought style to them.
And their own style.
Exactly.
Like, even between the two.
Rooftops, like, which is mainly like Care and Beach, just block letter stuff. Mm-hmm. Like they brought pieces up there. Like, yeah. Which is amazing, bro.
Yeah.
Yeah. Rest in peace, man.
And they had the best work up there, yo.
Definitely.
That Allegheny rooftop.
It was legendary.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's still there.
What's your favorite color, Paz? And what's your favorite paint?
American.
Earlier you said American accent. American, if you was to use European paint, like we're talking about the Montanas, the Ironlax, like what European paint you like?
I have, because I've done like a bunch of commission shit, and I did a bunch of jams and stuff like that. When you're doing that kind of stuff, European paint is usually just more available. I think Cobra is real good.
Cobra?
Cobra and Ironlax is real good, actually.
Yeah, Ironlax is just like real thick. The smell is just crazy.
I love Ironlax,
yeah.
Montana.
Yeah.
You like the Montana?
I mess with Cobra too, but one of them joints is watery, so.
I kind of like the oil-based shit better.
Yeah.
Like, not really too much the acrylic stuff.
How many gears you got in right now? From the the first time you started?
I guess 96, so today, so 20 years?
20 years, yeah.
Sure.
That's a long time. What dudes from Philly, like, you like when it comes to wickets? Like, when people speak about Far, when they talk about Karaz, when they speak about, you know...
I think Karaz.
Yeah, like throw a couple names out there that you always was a fan of.
When I was younger, like Dan kind of put me onto Karaz, because I think Karaz was from Fifth Street, and I think they kind of hung out together. But yeah, he definitely showed me like an appreciation for Wicked. I never had, like, I'll be honest, I don't have any skill with Wicked, but Scrap always had really good wickets.
Yeah, Rakan.
Yeah, and I think it's just because it's clean.
And he
it's
got his
readable.
Own styles,
it's not,
too.
Yeah, it's not too crazy. It's not just... It just doesn't look like scribble. Kane has a really good
wicket. Kane, that's another one. Indio. Like, I love Indio and Suppose,
man,
dude.
That tag for like, 12 Monkeys.
They are so original with their shit. They're so original with their shit.
Yeah, I like Indio a lot.
You know what's another great combo I always love? Earn and Enemy.
Oh, Earn and Enemy.
Oh my gosh, shout out to Earn.
I met him.
Enemy, he's probably, you know what I mean, listening. Yes. For people that want tattoos or people that want to get with you for walls, let them know where they can get with you at.
I got a little shop on Cotman Ave in Church Road called Louder Than Bombs. The phone number is 267-763-1399. You can check me out on social media, PastorTattoo666 on Instagram, Alex Pastor on Facebook, and holler at me if you got any projects worth doing or
design.
Yeah.
Like Past, like on the average, how much is a sleeve? Like on the average, something good with colors. I mean, we're talking 12, 13 or a little bit more.
Nah, yeah. Usually I do a full sleeve for around $5,000.
$5,000.
Like, that's like
full, oh my god.
But that's
awesome.
that's like full color, full color.
That's like the one that I put up.
Yeah.
Oh man.
Yeah.
Yeah, because I was wondering. I'm like, man, like it's gotta be expensive the work that you do.
Yeah. It's original too.
Oh, absolutely. Well, I mean, plus you're probably looking at like 30 hours of work. So,
I seen one that you did the ball back and it was like 6 sessions?
Yeah, that was 6 sessions, 30 hours, and he's probably got like close to $5,000 in already.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah, you definitely tattooed them heavy hitters, man.
Right?
I'm so proud of you, man. Like, you came so far, bro. Like, I remember being in Artscape with you and looking up to you as a piecer, and you know, now you coming down here to show us love. Like, it's a beautiful thing, man. Like, we definitely need this in Philly.
Yeah,
we need the unity, man. How you feel about like how graffiti's going right now with the love, like with the props? Remember how back in the day people used to go to meetings and people giving everybody books? Now I look at graffiti like, you know, the meetings ain't like that no more. You know what I mean? Meetings is always problems going on. So, like, how you look at graffiti now in that way?
I think the internet kind of, like...
Fucked it up, right?
Well, it kind of opened the floodgates and let everybody in. You know what I mean? So now you get a lot of suckers coming to meet, kind of coming.
Yeah, because before graffiti was like an elite thing. Well, everybody didn't write. Now everybody in England knows
you.
Part of our
culture. Invite you or bring you with them.
Yeah. Well, then it's kind of like the trade-off. Like you want it to be worldwide, and it is, but a lot of suckers come with that too. You know, I mean, you can't have it both ways.
You know,
hopefully, like one out of five of those toys will turn into a legitimate graffiti.
Yeah. Like, what advice would you give a good upcoming artist?
Right.
Like, what advice would Paz give a good, nice upcoming artist that really wants to do it for the history of it?
Don't try to be something you're not. If you're good at something, try to pursue that. Like, if you want to do street letters and do stuff like that and bomb, do it and pursue it. Try to be the best and most consistent you can. But I think the way you get remembered and the way you've got to separate yourself from everybody else. If you just have letters and letter forms like everybody else and hands like everybody else, then I think you're going to get lost in the herd. I think the most important thing is for people to kind of like separate themselves stylistically from everybody else. You know what I mean? Because that's the way you get remembered. You got to stand out from the herd.
Yeah,
but whatever you're, instead of trying to be a jack of all trades, whatever you're doing, master that and try to do it in your own way. Try to build up your style in your own way. Like, we're all on a kind of creative journey here. So like you say, like yeah, all letter forms have been done, but if you stick with it, eventually, if you keep coming up with new forms, you'll find your own style. I usually look at other people's stuff and think like, I wonder what the opposite of that would look like.
Right.
You know what I mean? Don't do anything like that at all. You know what I mean? Like if you see someone doing like bubble letters, I wonder what the opposite of bubble letters would look like. You know what I mean?
Do you see yourself maybe later on when you get a little older doing more freaks? Like, do you see yourself getting into that lane a little bit more?
I don't know. Growing up, I always kind of like looked at freaks kind of like a waste of time. Because you have to do so many of them
to get recognized.
Any kind of, yeah, and like,
and they're so hard too.
And I kind of looked at it as like I missed the boat. Like, I got too much other shit I want to do.
Right.
You know what I mean? So like,
time for it.
Yeah. And I feel like I kind of missed that time. So I don't want to try to be like, I don't want to try to fake it and like do freights all of a sudden and act like I've been here for years. You know?
No. I just meant it like, you know, sometimes when we get older, you know, we want to chill. You know, do some freights or some legal walls and, you know, not do the stuff that we used to do when we were younger, running around, bombing on trucks and even, you know what I'm saying? Like, we get older.
I would do more productions and stuff like that.
Right.
Stuff that can live forever.
I seen that wall you and Dan One did with the 9/11.
Oh, yeah.
With the fire. Mm-hmm. What's your favorite wall and what's your favorite collab wall?
Probably the 13th and South Wall.
Who was you with?
Me, Bird, Sue, and Lotus. The three-story album.
Ooh. Mm-hmm. You, Bird, Sue, and who else?
Lotus.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
How was it painting with them guys, man?
Especially
Sue. You know, I mean, it was awesome. I mean, that wall took a month to do. Like, we had the scaffolding and all that shit. Like, it was definitely... It was definitely like a real fucking start to finish production. And it wasn't just pieces and a background. It was like you had figures and we had all kinds of insect demons at the bottom. And like we had fucking stained glass in it and angels and shit. So that was probably my favorite wall. And everybody's got to be able to pull it off.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Now, Paz, do you have like a crazy chase story?
Not really. All my like every chase story I have, I always got caught.
You never got away?
No, I never got away. There was a couple times I went out painting on tripping on acid, on like train lines, like fucking around, thinking it was totally chill, and cops would come out of nowhere like looking for like kids that were throwing a kegger, and I would get locked up for it. Like, so there's nothing worse than sitting in a jail cell fucking.
What was the longest route you did? Like walking.
Walking? Did Fifth Street back in the day from Girard to almost Allegheny?
So from Girard to Allegheny on West Street on Fifth? Oh, that's a nice little route.
Almost took 4 hours on foot.
That's a nice walk. And who you was with again?
That was me and Slave, actually.
Oh, that was a nice walk. Mm. Definitely. I was in the internet and seen some pictures with you and Kane.
Yeah.
It was on like blue on the truck. Like how was it writing with Kane? Like how was it writing with the infamous Kane?
That was awesome. That was right after he got tattooed.
Oh yeah?
Yeah, I tattooed him. We hung out for a little bit and then he took me out, we hit a couple spots. Yeah.
Okay.
I remember we painted a barbershop together too. Like his friend of
the Yeah, the one on Fifth Street. Yeah. His barbershop.
And we did the roll
down. Yeah, I remember that. Yeah, I did that pull downs across the street. Yeah. Awesome, yeah.
But that's one of those things that got me hyped, because I was painting with someone that you wouldn't expect to see me with. And that I always kinda like that.
Are you doing anything new that you got planned? Any wall you
spring is coming up.
Yeah, I mean, I have like 3 or 4 walls lined up for spring. I still have like 5 or 6. I have 5 or 6 trucks that need to get done. So I mean, yeah, there's definitely some shit on the horizon this spring. I'm just waiting for the weather to clear. Creative in anything, you have to kind of get your ideas from a wide selection of different kinds of art where you can pull influences from. Like if you just look at graffiti, like you're gonna get burnt out, you know what I mean? So I kind of draw influence from I cast a wide net, you know what I mean? I think with them buffing stuff so readily now, it's kind of hard. The main challenge is to get stuff to live, you know what I mean? So there's kind of like 2 routes you can go. You can either do like spots that won't necessarily be seen right away, but will live forever. Or you can do spots that everybody will see, but it'll probably get buffed within a week or two.
Yeah, I like being doggy spots behind the gates.
And with that takes plot, that takes, you know, wisdom. A lot of people just don't know that.
Oh, absolutely. And I think it takes more than that. I think it takes a lot of research. Like, you gotta sneak out spots like you went in a bank robbery.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Have you been in the tunnels?
I've been in the Fern Rock tunnels, but never in the...
How far you went?
To
2 stations in?
I think we made it to Erie.
We?
From
who
Fern
was
Rock?
With?
I was with Slim.
Oh,
from Fern Rock?
No, not from Fern Rock.
Yo, I heard they buffing up the Erie now.
Yeah, they are starting above the orange line, yeah.
That's crazy.
Like right now, the stuff is still living. The stuff is still living. Well, when the Pope came, they buffed from like Center City down.
Nah, man, nothing's sacred.
So now they're starting to go up, but like up Alani,
that's
still living.
Anybody that he was bombing is probably living down there. They're living down there. It's hard, you know?
Yeah, you know, I mean, you know, that's why I like when it comes to tunnels, man, that's a
when did they buff the stuff. When did they buff the 2nd Street tunnels?
98? Yeah, 98 they buffed it, yeah. And then, you know, when the Pope came, they started buffing.
He was trying to say some dumb shit, and it was Kane that got it buffed, but nah.
Fuck out
of here. Right, exactly. That's what I said. I was like, y'all get the fuck out of here, you know what I'm saying?
So,
that shit probably was planning to get before you hit it, you know what I'm saying?
Are you planning to go back down tunnels anytime soon in the future?
Yeah, I'd love to. But it's like one of those things you can't go by. Like, I wouldn't go by myself. So, I would like to get shit together where I can go with a bunch of people.
Earlier, you brought up that you and Kane did a barbershop on Fifth Street. Like, strictly he's on a mission, he's, you know, bombing lethal, like he's straight hitting shit.
I think that mission involved like a couple.
So hold on, you gotta get on the mic. Come here, get on the mic. Come on, Kelly. No, just talk. Talk on the mic. You don't gotta put your mask on, just talk. Go ahead, just talk.
I said that mission involved a couple Coronas, I believe, right?
Yeah, I think we did do that.
That shit was more like a party though.
Yeah, it was. But I don't know Kane had like, I don't know Kane could produce like that, actually.
Me neither.
I'm one of the best yet. Some punks ain't paid all of their debts yet. Driving a fly, riding high on the jet set.